You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Health in Public Education. Today, we're going to talk about nutrition and lifetime fitness. One of the questions we want to address during this class session is, how can K-12 school health education improve physical health and academic outcomes? Let's go ahead and start by looking at some data. It's no surprise to anyone who's watching this program that childhood obesity is almost at epidemic proportions throughout the United States. It's been an ongoing issue for many years, and as you can see by the chart behind me, it has significantly increased since the late 1960s, early 70s. In fact, in 2008, the percentage of youth who were classified as obese was 4 times greater than it was 50 years ago. 4.2% of youth age 6 to 11 were obese in 1970. In 2008, it was 19.6. For children who were aged 12 to 19 years old, it was 4.6% were obese in 1970, and in 2008, 18.1%. 1 in 3 children and adolescents, not shown on this graph, 1 in 3, 33% of children are classified as obese. Obesity affects every ethnicity, race, age, and we all know that it's a challenge. It's a challenge for each of us personally. It's a challenge for us professionally. It's something we need to reflect upon and make concerted efforts to make lifetime choices and changes. And the reason why it's so significant within the school-age population and youth is because studies have shown that obesity does have a correlation to poor academic performance. So as we said, 1 in 3 children and adolescents, 33%, are obese or overweight. It affects everybody. No one is immune. It impacts physical, academic, social, and emotional. Childhood obesity also informs the likelihood of adult obesity and chronic life-threatening conditions. We've really started to track data in the United States, and we have a map that we're going to show on the screen. And as we pull up this screen, as we pull up this shot, and we're looking at this map, this comes from the Youth Risk Behavior Surveillance System in 2017, and it shows the progression throughout the United States. So the states that you see in white are those where the data is not available or it was in such a significantly small respondent rate that it wasn't statistically significant. So the states that have the darkest blue, which are in the southern and central part of the U.S., have a 15 to 22% obesity rate. When we take a look at these states, we have to ask ourselves, what are the prevailing factors? I've heard some people say that it is the more common diet and foods of choice. Some people have said that there is a trend for not recognizing lifetime physical activity. But through education, we can inform parents, educators, and young people about the value of sleep, nutrition, and physical activity. Even in California here, we're at 14% for childhood obesity. So it's a statistically significant issue across the U.S. Let's go ahead and go to another chart, and this particular chart shows us adult obesity. And as we look at this full screen, you can see throughout the United States, there's a significant issue. And again, we're seeing a high rate of adult obesity in some of our southern states, Oklahoma, Arkansas, Mississippi, Alabama, Louisiana. And then it moves to Texas and the central and southern states. Then it moves up to the western and the northeastern states. And the states that seem to have the least likelihood of adult obesity include the Washington, D.C. area, Hawaii, and Colorado. So when we take a look at obesity, we have to take a look at the factors that impact children and adults. And it's not just an adult concern anymore. In children, what we see in childhood obesity is high cholesterol, type 2 diabetes, and impaired glucose tolerance, high blood pressure. Interestingly, and not surprisingly to many school professionals, obese children are also likely to have poor social interaction and poor self-esteem, sleep disturbances, orthopedic health issues. And the adults are no surprise, we hear about this all the time. Heart disease, cancer, stroke, type 2 diabetes, arthritis, high blood pressure, sleep apnea, and physical disabilities. Our public health focus on childhood obesity reflects concern for children's health, not their physical appearance. The focus is on the health and well-being of America's children. The health and well-being of America's children, not on physical appearance. And that should really be the driving force for all of the work that we do in public health and public education, is to take a focus on making sure that we empower all children and families to make responsible health-promoting decisions to help young children physically, academically, and socially progress throughout their lifetime, so that in adulthood, they're happy, healthy, well-rounded, physically active, wake up refreshed, and have no chronic physical ailments. The rise in rates in obesity in children we're seeing more and more with these kinds of health issues that we never saw historically. And so when we look at this data, we also know that it isn't just a matter of obesity, it's making good health choices. And the data is clear. 46% of children who eat breakfast earn A grades. 46% of children who eat breakfast have A grades. Take a pause for a moment. I stopped into a coffee shop, a nationwide chain, and a parent, I assumed it was a parent because the child called her mom. The parent brought the child in and bought the child, and if I'm guessing, I would say the child was early elementary, no older than third or fourth grade. And the breakfast for this child was a coffee beverage and a sugary pastry. And that's what the mother provided. When we talk about breakfast, we want a protein. We want a grain. We want a fruit or vegetable. We want to ensure that it is well-rounded because that fuels us for the day. So breakfast, lunch, dinner, and healthy snacks throughout the day, coupled with physical activity, and research has shown children should be getting 60 minutes per day. That's why our state physical education standards have actual minutes embedded within them as to the amount of physical education and physical activity children should have on a daily basis. 43% of students who drank one glass of milk per day earned A grades. 52% who engage in physical activity five or more days earn A grades. And again, physical activity is defined as a duration of time, about 60 minutes, where your heart is increased and you're getting aerobic benefits. Your heart is beating at a little bit of a faster pace, you're breathing a little bit harder, you might be sweating to cool your body down, all of that to be able to move your body into a phase where you're more likely to burn fat for energy and burn calories for energy. 18% of children who watch three or more hours of TV per day earn A grades. That means 82% do not. One in six children are food insecure. Food insecure means they don't have access to food, access to nutrition, access to adequate food intake in the amount of calories they need to grow and develop. And this data is from 2015 from Child Trends. So when we look at this data as public education professionals, as health professionals, reflect upon how this data can inform decision makers at schools and in the community to really develop advocacy opportunities to educate and inform about why it's so important that schools take a look at their policies and their programs and their strategies. In fact, it's so important that in 2005, the federal government established that every school across the United States had to have a federal wellness policy that highlighted and outlined nutrition, and physical activity. And every child nutrition director in every public school across the United States will help illustrate what the parameters are that they have to work within in order to meet these federal regulations to ensure that the meals that are served, the beverages that are served, the snacks that are served during school-sponsored events, and after school meet these nutritional guidelines. There are state and federal assessment tools that schools use to sort of grade themselves on whether or not their food and beverage policies, the access to nutritional foods and beverages, fundraising activities, are they grounded in unhealthy snacks? So often in the United States, we have to advocate for choosing other mechanisms to fundraise besides using pizza parties or other kinds of non-nutritious foods as a mechanism to raise money. The old candy bar sales. We need to shift that paradigm and come up with something else that isn't food related as a fundraiser. Candy sales are not an effective fundraiser. And across the United States, as we're trying to address the issue of childhood obesity, we need to rethink how we look at food. Through the federal Every Student Succeeds Act, which came about in 2016, which was an outgrowth of No Child Left Behind, we are required to have student nutrition education, parent education, staff development, and policy analysis. And here in California, it's actually written into our ed code to make sure that we have some nutrition education. So when we take a look at the approach that we're taking within the K-12 arena within our schools, we have federal policy, we have state policy, we have district policy, but a policy is only as effective as it's being implemented at the local level. And that's why advocacy and education is so important. Every school, every district across the United States is required to have a stakeholder committee to address wellness, every single one. Every single one since 2005 is required to have a wellness committee, partly to address these federal and state requirements, but also it serves as a mechanism to stop and reflect upon not just nutrition and physical activity, staff wellness, look at access to nutritious foods, look at what happens during after school and school-sponsored events like football games or soccer games or arts and music events after school. Oftentimes I'll go into a school, I'll be invited to go to an event, a sporting event or an arts event. As soon as I walk in, there are food sales, booster sales that rely upon non-nutritious foods. So when we look at this whole issue of obesity in our school age population, we have to start by looking at what the policies are. And our federal and state policies provide the guidance and support to our local school districts and schools to ensure that we are offering nutritious meals, snacks, and beverages to our student population. And the sky is the limit. There are grants available. There are nonprofit groups that provide support. There are government entities that provide support. It's a matter of we as the education professionals and the health professionals to speak up and say, what are we doing in our local public schools to ensure that we are addressing the issue of childhood obesity through the required federal wellness policy mandates, our state guidelines for nutrition and physical activity, and the fact that every school across the United States, every district across the United States is supposed to have a stakeholder committee to address wellness. And although the committee's focus primarily is on nutrition and physical activity, it can be used to address all areas of health and wellness within our schools. And as I said, there's a myriad of resources for us to pull from. So let's go to some of these websites now. The first website is the Food and Nutrition Services branch of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. This is the branch that provides all of the guidance on the local school wellness policy. The wellness policy links and an outreach and toolkit. And as you look at this toolkit, it even has presentation materials. And we'll try to upload these, and they'll definitely be in the course folders for you to look at. And it's a PowerPoint presentation that you can download on your own. You don't even have to create it. You can just pull right from here and utilize it to help educate and inform and be an advocate for school wellness, school nutrition, and physical activity. So there's presentation materials right here for staff, presentation materials for parents. There's resources for social media posts in multiple languages. And again, this is all from the U.S. Department of Agriculture, because they're the ones that provide the guidance for our local school wellness policy. Data and research, child nutrition tables. All of this information provides the data to address some of the issues related to school breakfast participation, milk, summer food service, everything. And the reason why is because when public schools implement their nutrition services program, their child nutrition program, it's a reimbursement program. And so the school systems provide data that goes to the state level to get their reimbursement, which goes to the federal level to allow for reimbursement. And that's why we have all of this data, whether it's done during regular school, after school, summer session, whatever it might be, because it's a reimbursement program. Very few people realize that child nutrition in our public schools, very few people realize that they are financially self-sustaining. They rely on these reimbursements to be able to cover their costs and operate. Very few child nutrition programs across the country depend upon funding from the school system. Even though they're part of the school system and they are employed by the school system, very few actually pull from funding sources the way that classroom teachers might pull or administrators might pull. They are pretty much operating as a separate entity in terms of financial reimbursement. That's why when parents, and I'm going to put a, as a colleague of mine who's a director of child nutrition would appreciate, I'm going to put information out there that says, if you are a parent and you are saying, yes, I'm going to go ahead and pay for my child's nutrition, and then your child receives nutrition through the child nutrition program, but you don't reimburse the district, that takes away from the funding of this program. This program is a reimbursable program, and they depend upon those families that are saying, yes, I want to participate, as are those who need to participate because there's no other food source for children and families. Those that are opting in and say, yes, I'll go ahead and pay a fee to, you know, make it easier so my child participates in nutrition at school, those child nutrition directors really need for you to make sure that you pay those bills and pay the school if you're opting in for the child nutrition services, because they're not getting the funding sources that other branches of public education are, and they rely upon cost reimbursement at the state and federal level. And if your child doesn't qualify for that level, then it's a burden, and it's such a fine fiscal line that they operate on, that if you're going to utilize the child nutrition services, which is certainly your option and it's great, it's important to make sure that if you're opting in, that you pay those bills, because they need that funding. Here are some grants. Here's information about the agency. Here's more information on data and research related to food and child nutrition. Let's go to another site. We'll do this one. The Healthy Schools Campaign. This again is a nonprofit group that provides guidance and support to make healthy changes. And you can register and take a look at all of the resources and programs that they have. School Health Access Collaboratives, issues related to education and health services. Here you see they're doing a lot of work around nutrition and education, absenteeism. So there's many, many resources that are available. Here's one on school food. We'll click on that for a second. So if you're someone who's part of this class or just watching this program and you're thinking, you know, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to, for my class project, do an advocacy project on school nutrition and childhood obesity. There's a myriad of resources that are out there. It's incredible the amount of resources that we have. Here's another one, which is the Alliance for a Healthier Generation. This is the one that actually provides incentives where schools can identify themselves as platinum, gold, silver, and bronze. And they go through a whole series of guidance tools and processes and action steps to help you work towards that award. And some schools really like to have that recognition as a National Healthy School Award. Sorry, bronze, silver, and gold levels. There's no platinum. So there's a myriad of resources available to us related to this. You can see there's America's Healthiest Schools is posted right here. Oh, you have to sign in, so I'm not going to sign in. But there's a whole host of resources so that you can view throughout the United States where America's healthiest schools are. And these are the ones that have opted in to join the Alliance for a Healthier Generation and go through the process that is directly aligned with the federal wellness policy and whatever that respective state's policies are, because each one has a regional and a state lead within every respective state. To encourage schools to adopt their guidance at no charge to be able to identify themselves as a healthier school, either at a bronze, silver, or gold level. And the reason why there's no charge is because it's underwritten by a variety of partnerships, including the Heart Association. All right, I want to take you to my plate. So this particular website is part of the federal government. Again, it's USDA, and it is phenomenal. I wish this teaching tool was available when I was in the classroom. In fact, we're going to go to a sample of a lesson a little bit later in this segment, and I'll show you how I utilize this as part of a lesson. So what you do is you click on a food group to explore. So we're going to click on fruits, and then we're going to go to the food gallery. And as we do that, all of the information about what's considered a fruit, all of the information about what we'd need with nutrition and health benefits related to fruits is all right here. Historically, in education, we spent a lot of our time focusing on having students just recall the facts. We don't need to do that. And we have learned that factual recall isn't necessarily correlated to changing behavior or skill development. Now what we do is we have students access this resource, access these facts, access this valid health information, which is one of our national health education skills, and utilize it as part of an overarching project. So instead of having students memorize the nutritional value within a grapefruit or an orange, we have them access and utilize where they can get this information. And in the 21st century, it's literally right in the palm of your hand, right on your laptop, right on your desktop, right on your tablet. So with this particular site, which is choosemyplate.gov, there's so many resources. And this is a wonderful tool for every educator and guest speaker or presenter or advocate who's out there to utilize it as part of an instructional program at any grade level. Let's click on grains. Okay, let's click on protein. All right, the server's moving slowly. But when you go to every single one of these, it gives you an opportunity to select and go through and identify how you can access this information and apply it to an instructional program. I also want to take us to, I'm going to close that window, close that window, California Department of Education. If you want to learn more about school nutrition, this is a phenomenal resource. Everything you want to know, from procurement to administrative guidance, to what nutrition programs look like, to the forms, everything you want to know about school nutrition is on this site. California has done a phenomenal job of making it easily accessible for every school person and for every advocate to learn more about school nutrition services. Here's the California Fruit and Vegetable Program, the history and the guidelines. Sometimes there are grants available. Sometimes there are opportunities to become more actively involved, as I said, at your school district wellness committee. And it's good to educate yourself in advance to see exactly what you need to know going into the program to be able to ask the questions about where your school system is in terms of addressing childhood obesity and health and wellness for students. And here are the California standards for education. And as we go through, you'll see nutrition education is front and center. Let me do it a little faster. Nutrition and physical activity. And as we go through each one, let's pull up mental, emotional, physical, right here. So this is standard one, kindergarten. Name a variety of healthy foods and explain why they're necessary for good health. Recognize that not all products advertised or sold are good for you. Skills to access this don't start until grade two. Why? Because they're little kindergartners. So you can have a discussion about it, but in terms of assessing it at kindergarten, that's not necessary until grade two. But one of the skills is interpersonal communication. How to ask a family member for healthy foods. Decision making, how to participate in active play and enjoy physical activities. Practicing behaviors. You can do activities with children, which is a higher order critical thinking skill, where they have to self-advocate or self-manage or advocate for others by planning a nutritious meal like breakfast, choosing healthy foods in a variety of settings, and selecting nutritious snacks. That's where the choose my plate can come in handy for educators by going through and accessing all of these resources so that as a teacher, you recognize that you don't have to spend the time to pull it all down. It's right at the palm of your hands. So when we take a look at this, what we're trying to say is when it comes to addressing childhood obesity, there are so many resources that are available to us to ensure that we take a whole school, whole community, whole child approach. And again, more than ever, the issue of childhood obesity really is interwoven with all of these pieces of the whole school, whole community, whole child approach. Whether it is accessing and utilizing the toolkit or working with childhood nutrition at the school site, focusing on policies related to wellness, making sure children have access to daily physical activity and physical education, making sure children have access to daily health education, including nutrition education, making sure there's opportunities for staff involvement and staff wellness, and making sure there's opportunities for parent and family engagement to educate and inform about the strategies, resources, policies, and guidance to improve childhood nutrition, improve physical activity, improve academic outcome, improve social and self-esteem, and reduce childhood obesity. That's what we're here to do. So I want to go ahead and take you to some videos that are from the myplate.gov, and we're going to run a series of three of them just so that you can see what MyPlate has to offer. So we're going to step away for a moment to those videos, and then we'll come right back.
Why do they always have to serve a salad? I don't even eat it. Ugh.
Fruit, veggie, swag. Fruit, veggie, swag. Make it happen. Get it. Lunchbox, paper bag. Fruit, veggie, swag. Fruit, veggie, swag. Keep it fresh. Keep it clean. Fruits and veggies on the scene. Chips and sodas, they're so malicious. Eat your five a day.
ambitious.
Make it half your plate, fruits and vegetables.
Hype means healthy you, positive energy. This year, we are walking to school, choosing water over soda, and finding fun ways to get active. So each morning, our youth wellness council is leading movement breaks for the younger students.
When I go to the corner store, I don't just pick up a soda or a candy or anything unhealthy. I pick up an apple or orange or banana.
Our school is working to get rid of junk food and wants to make more healthy options available to kids. This year, we learned about My Plate and know that half of our plate should be filled with fruits and vegetables. We're selling salads and fruits instead of candy.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
My favorite vegetables is broccoli and broccoli.
My school has a youth wellness council. I've joined to help make my school a healthier place.
We are meeting each week to talk about new ways to get our school healthy. Last fall, we went to the Youth Leadership Summit. We learned what it means to be hype and are now the leaders for healthy change in our school.
I'm proud to be a youth leader.
You can take the stairs instead of the elevator. That's hype. Eat an apple instead of a bag of chips. That's hype. Hype is something I can relate to, not just in my school, but also in my neighborhood.
We are in the mood to make Philadelphia schools more healthy and more active. So join us. Find out more information about how to get involved at www.letsmove.gov.
Healthy you, positive energy, high!
So as you can see, the federal MyPlate.gov website, which is part of the U.S. Department of Agriculture, they've done a phenomenal job over the years. They really have. They've done a phenomenal job. They have made this user-friendly, interactive, in such a way that it's easy for people to understand. The food pyramid was wonderful, but it became very confusing for a lot of folks. So the MyPlate helps people to really stop and assess by the size and the amount, more vegetables and fruits and protein and grains and dairy, and then all of those sugary sweets are off the plate, which means that you have them in moderation. It's not always easy, but you have them in moderation. And so this myplate.gov website that we've gone to, we've already shown you many of the options that are available to you. So let's talk about some practical things that you can do every single day. When I worked at the State Department of Ed in another state, it was an agriculturally rich state, much like California is an agriculturally rich state. And what we did is we had a farmer who would come by and have a small little table set up. And so I approached this individual and I approached the decision makers that I worked with at the State Department of Ed, and I said, can we expand this a little bit? Can we do more? And so I proposed an idea where we would have a staff development opportunity and then work with the farmers in this community. And we developed what was called the Farmer on the Mall. Much like in Sacramento, if you've ever been up there, there's a beautiful garden that's right outside the government offices. A lot of State Department of Education offices have that. In North Carolina, we had the same thing. And there was this beautiful mall, and the farmer would come every Thursday, and we had a Farmer on the Mall. And that one gentleman in his farmer jeans, the local farmer who would bring all of his fruits and vegetables in, he would come to the office and actually did a lesson on strawberries. And he did a whole lesson on strawberries and gave examples of strawberry beverages and strawberry uses of strawberries. And it was just fascinating because all of the staff became engaged in it and really connected. Well, that grew and grew and grew so that every Thursday, from about 10 in the morning till 1 in the afternoon, there was a whole host of farmers on the mall. And people during their lunch break would go out to that mall and visit the farmer's market and then go back to work. So at lunch, during their lunch break, they'd go out to the farmer's market and then come right back. So what can you do within your local community, within your school, and within your district to come up with innovative ways to bring the idea of nutrition and healthy foods that are rich in protein, rich in whole grains, rich in vitamins and minerals with fruits and vegetables. Where can you bring all of this onto your campuses and into your communities? Where can you find partnerships where you connect with those in the community and provide opportunities for people to be able to have that nutrition-rich experience come to them? Another one is, how are you walking at lunch? I work at a school district, and in this particular school district, the principal had an activity where students who were demonstrating positive behavior or students who demonstrated growth, one of the rewards would be to walk with the principal. And so during lunchtime, they would go ahead and either have lunch with the principal, or they would go ahead and have a walking period during their break where they would walk and talk with the principal around the campus. Where are we doing that in our community? As I came onto campus here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills, and I was coming in, I saw people walking around the campus. We have to allow for those breaks to occur, even 15 or 20 minutes. Every little bit of physical activity is better than no physical activity at all. And the more that we increase the duration and the frequency, and even the intensity, the more health benefits we're going to have. I'm not saying that people need to be athletes or competitors or champions, but what we need to do is embed daily physical activity into our routine, embed nutritious food choices into our daily routine, and find ways to make that happen. In a city like Los Angeles, there are times where we're in our cars for an hour at a time or an hour and a half, simply because the traffic is just so overwhelming that it could take you an hour and a half to go 30 miles. And that's true in a lot of large cities like Atlanta and DC and New York and Chicago and Boston and others. And so what can we do to make sure that we as adults model to children in our families the value of important physical activity and nutritional opportunities? So how often do you go out with your children? Are you walking with your children? Is there an opportunity to just go out and have some fun in a park? When you come home from work, do you put on your shoes and go out with your children? When you're at school, do you illustrate the value of physical activity? Do the children see that during your break at school, you might take an opportunity to just embed 10 or 15 minutes of physical activity into your routine as your schedule allows? So where are we as a society and as a community shifting that paradigm for increased physical activity and nutritional choices? And there are times every single day to make that happen. And again, we're not focusing on competitive athletics. We're not focusing on athletics. We're not focusing on champion competition. It's just physical activity and lifetime fitness. Something you enjoy doing. If the child doesn't enjoy bicycle riding, then don't highlight bicycle riding. If the child enjoys swimming, swimming. If the child doesn't enjoy soccer, don't encourage soccer, encourage something they enjoy. So you have to connect the physical activity options with something that's enjoyable. Because even as adults, if it's something we don't enjoy, we're not going to continue. And be patient with your children as well as yourselves. You know, the body is adaptive. We've talked about this. And you can't just jump on an exercise bike and do 30 minutes at 90% of your capability. You could become injured or physically exhausted. You have to gradually increase to that level. But at the most, we want to see 30 to 60 minutes of daily activity for adults. And it's recommended 60 minutes of activity for children every day. And when students perceive benefit to themselves for physical activity and lifetime fitness, when they have access to the equipment and they see their peers and adults around them seeing activity as a priority, nutrition as a priority, sleep as a priority, academics as a priority, they see that that's a priority for them as well. So we want to make sure that we see that there is benefits to learning the activities as you would in physical education. And if you look at the physical education standards and the health education standards, there is a great deal of overlap. Physical education standards at the state and national level include personal and social responsibility, just as the health education standards at the state and national level are grounded in personal and social responsibility and healthy, responsible decision making. So although physical education is guided around physical activity, over the years, physical education throughout the United States has really shifted the focus to ensure that there's a strong emphasis on personal and social responsibility, on peer and social interaction, on motor movement and all of that, but also lifetime fitness. And so in health education, that's where the two go hand in hand, where we really want to focus on the well-being physically, because when you're physically well, we know that it also impacts you socially, emotionally, mentally, and academically as well. So let's take a look at some various models. This one is the My Activity Pyramid. And this comes out of the University of Missouri. And we're going to blow this up large screen so you can really take a good look at this model. And again, over the years, we've sort of shifted some of the graphics so that they're a bit more user-friendly. And as you see here, at the top is inactivity. So at the top of that, we want to minimize inactivity. We want to increase muscle strengthening 3 times a week. We want to do some aerobic activity every single day. And aerobic activity is defined as 60 to 90% of your maximum aerobic output every single day. Running, biking, swimming, surfing, any kind of activity that increases your heart rate, increases your respiratory rate to increase the circulation and shift your body's biochemistry to start to utilize stored glucose, glycogen, and then fat as fuel. And when we do that for 45 to 60 minutes every single day, it really has an impact academically, socially, physically, emotionally, and mentally. And so when we're doing designated or integrated instruction, this is a good tool to help illustrate that, yes, we want to do lifestyle and lifetime activities as often as possible, but then take a look at aerobic activity. So we're going to watch a couple videos, and these videos are known as energizers. And before we go to the video, I want to illustrate why we're seeing this across the United States. What we have learned is even short spurts of physical activity, kind of like what some people sometimes call a brain break, when they're embedded within the instructional program, 3 to 5 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes within the instructional program, it helps concentration and cognition among young people. There was a time where I worked a great deal with after-school programs. And when I looked at how the after-school programs were structured, many of the after-school programs would have the children come in and just get right to homework. And my recommendation to them was to sort of flip their schedule a little bit. Because of what we understand and know about children and cognition and physical health, mental, emotional health, I said, you know, they're in school, they want to be able to be physically active. So when they come in and they check in, that's when you want to do your physical activity. Transition them right to that physical activity piece. Give them an opportunity to engage in physical activity for 30 minutes or so. Then bring them back, give them their bathroom breaks, give them their snack breaks, give them a time for homework. Then have them go through their instructional program. Bring them back and have them do a little homework. Then do their instructional program and embed a little bit of a 5-minute energizer. So whether it's during the regular school day or before or after school, let's take a look at one example of a classroom energizer.
Okay, boys and girls, it's time for the brain to grow. Let's get started. Up. Step, step, step. Get those knees up. Come on now. You can move it. You can move it. I'm looking to see who's moving. If you're moving, smile at me. Big smile, baby. Oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. Hop, and hop, and hop, and hop. Stop and roll it out.
I just want to close my eyes, so bored I can't disguise.
To your left.
Each word a lullaby, I'm tuning out.
To your right.
Somehow I must explain, we must engage the brain.
To the middle.
And stop the power drain.
Down
I'm
low.
Too shy.
Now bag it up, bag it up.
Get up, get excited.
Slide it in and out. Slide it in and out. Pick up the pace and jump rope. Jump rope. Jump rope. Boxer style. Heel, toe, heel, toe. Heel, toe, work that wrist. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Little bit faster, run. Chop, 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 chop. Go, 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 and walk. And walk, and walk, and walk. Now stop it. Here we go.
The teacher's lesson plans are more than I can stand.
Oh yeah.
My thoughts are in my hands. Change.
Are you smiling? Big smile.
Get up, we'll take flight.
Now laugh.
Not like dynamite.
Now laugh.
Such a groove, yeah, that's right. You know what I mean.
Change the light bulb.
I'll call it by its name.
Impressive. Change the light bulb. Reach up there. Reach up. Reach up. Deltoid muscles. Your deltoids.
Wake up your neo.
Oh yeah.
The image it projects.
Oh yeah.
Body in motion.
Chest bounce.
Come on, come on, get up.
Chest mag.
Let it on out the knee, but try to hide it. You know you want to get up on your feet now.
Run in place. Run. 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 Faster. 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 Come on. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And stop, dip, walk, walk, clap. Louder. 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 Louder, louder, louder. Louder. Snap those things. Here we go. Here we go. Hands out and wave. Current wave. Current way, current way. Let's box now, hold it. And punch, and punch, and punch, and punch, and punch. Uppercut, everybody. Uppercut, 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 uppercut. Here, let's play basketball. Just dribble, dribble, dribble. Yes, yes, yes. Change hands, switch it over with the left hand. Dribble, dribble. Now run. Check it out. Check it out. Jump shots coming. Here we jump. And shoot. Jump. And shoot. Jump. And shoot. Jump. And shoot. And shoot. Defense. And chop. And chop. And chop. And chop. And chop. And chop. Now walk.
We got the wiggles out. We got to shake and shout.
Take it out.
That's what the song's about.
Take it out. Take it out. Touch your knee.
It was a real.
Get it up high.
Distractions will decrease.
Get it up high.
And now my mind's at peace.
Get it up high. Here we go.
Now I am all awake and ready to intake.
Hands out.
To a short break to class.
Get ready to squat and squat.
Now listen carefully
and squat.
The difference you can see
and squat.
Instruct us thoughtfully. We're
and squat
ready to learn.
And squat and squat. Stay with me.
Get up, get excited.
And walk.
Don't have to leave, but try to hide.
And clap.
You want to get up on your feet.
And clap. And clap and move. Big smiles now. Big smiles now. Big smiles. Big smiles. Here we go. Wait. 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 Slow it down. Walk. And walk. And walk. Check it out. Roll our shoulders back. Roll them to the front. To the front. To the front. Reach up wide. Bring it down. Breathe in. Back up to your heart and squeeze it. One, two, three, sit. Now your brain should be full of energy. Thank you, boys and girls. Thank you, teachers.
Now that particular energizer, it makes you just want to get up and, you know, participate. This man is just incredibly motivating with the students. And all of these are free. I've downloaded some of them from YouTube, and in the course, I'll embed them as to where they are. So whether it is something that is a book that guides you how to embed energizers into your instructional program, or you're pulling from videos that you can model into your program, there's a lot of commercial vendor-based instructional programs, especially the social emotional learning programs that have embedded physical activity. Have embedded reflection. We're calling it mindfulness. Mindfulness has benefit, but so does the energizer component as well. So embedding mindfulness, which is more of a reflection and a quieting, sort of a more of a deep breathing experience, that has benefit, but but so do the Energizer benefits. So let's take a look at another example of an Energizer, a little bit different, but along the same lines of how we want to embed short spurts of physical activity within the instructional day for children of all ages, even adults. I mean, adults are told, get up and move. Don't just sit at that desk all day. So here's another example of an Energizer to embed within a classroom setting. So when we look at the whole school, whole community, whole child approach, what we're saying is we want to provide opportunities for young people to grow and develop throughout their lifetime with nutrition, physical activity, sleep and rest, be disease-free, be engaged in their own learning academically. And really it does come down to sleep, eating well, nutritiously, daily physical activity, avoiding drugs and alcohol, and fun every single day of your life. It's great to laugh every single day. There's a lot to say for having, you know, just a good outlook and a genuine outlook and engaged in those relationships. We know that the number one factor that is going to prevent people from engaging in healthy eating and physical activity is time, followed by resources. So if we know it's time and resources, what can we do ahead of time to prepare nutritious meals at home in advance? Pop them in the freezer and bring them out. What can we do to embed even short spurts of physical activity, hopefully getting to that 60 minutes every single day? If we know the factor that is impeding our ability to engage in daily physical activity and nutrition is time and resources. What can we do to address that? From a school health education standpoint, when we take that whole person approach, we want to make sure that our parents and families are partners, that our administrators and school board members are advocates, that as professionals, we recognize school health education as an instructional discipline guided by standards. Now, in terms of health education teachers, there is a shortage in our state. So there are not as many of folks like me as there used to be, for a variety of different reasons. So what California did is that they said, if you're a credentialed school nurse, you can add a credential onto your nursing credential so that you are authorized to teach health education. But remember, we want K through 12 comprehensive sequential instruction, just like we have K through 12 comprehensive sequential instruction in English and math and social sciences. And so when we go to the California Department of Ed resource map, we want to recognize that even at our state level, we are advocating for the whole person. We are advocating for all partners working collaboratively to ensure that health and wellness through instruction as guided by the standards is in place. And that's why when we look at instruction, we look at those four keys for school health education. What is it the children need to know? What is it that they need to do? How do we assess that they're doing it in the classroom and in the real world? And that's why, what's the health information that children need to know? What are the skills they need to develop? What are the concepts they need to understand? And where are their opportunities to practice and apply them in the real world? So I created this four-piece puzzle, because really when you look at the what, why, how, and when, that's what health education refers to. What do I need to know? What are some of the concepts and skills? How do I demonstrate? In this particular case, I suggested using pre-printed health benefits phrases or gallery walk and attach those to foods charted on the work wall. So let's say that students have a take that concept information, and the formative assessment is the ability to determine whether or not students can chart it on the work wall to be able to correlate the food with the health benefit. Then we introduce the formative skill, and in this particular case, it's accessing realistic and reliable and valid health resources. So where do they go? ChooseMyPlate.gov. And now they're going to critique a poster to determine whether or not the foods that are on there are nutritious. And once they do that, you give them a pre-printed list that includes the benefits, and then you have to tally the number of health and learning benefits. So what you're doing is making sure that they can access that resource and extract the purposeful information on that resource. And then in step four, we want to reinforce and restate the health value for those decisions. And that's where you would do a think, pair, share to see whether or not students are able to articulate or illustrate or visualize the health and learning benefits of nutritional food and beverage choices. The next one is to correlate the skill to influences on behavior. So maybe what they're going to do is do a quick post on how to choose myplate.gov that can be shared with friends and family. So now you're moving to the next level, where they're relating to the skill to analyzing peer and social influences. So now we've got three components of the National Health Education Standards: core concept, analyzing peer and social influences, and accessing valid resources and information. As we get to step six, now we're going to introduce guided and independent practice. And we've talked about this before, and we've illustrated some of the work around guided practice. Guided practice isn't just throwing the steps of the skill out there. It's illustrating each step of the skill, modeling it, and then stopping at each step of the skill to check for student understanding. So step one, stop and assess. Step two, stop and assess. Step three, stop and assess. Oh, there's two students who don't have it? Reteach it. And go through each step of the skill. And then you go to independent practice, where students progress through all steps of the skill in small groups. When we get to step seven, that's where we would use the practice scenarios to ensure that you're checking for understanding so that all students are comprehending and mastering those skills. Then we want to assign practice to real-world situations in step 8. So in step 8, we're assigning practice to real-world situations. And in this example, I said, okay, in Teams, let's go ahead and select and exchange information about how it can be shared with others. So now they're working in small groups and taking it to higher order critical thinking, where they're building upon what they have learned and identifying ways for them to be able to share it with others. And so in step 9, the teams are going to develop a health advocacy poster that illustrates one health and one learning benefit of the Choose My Plate category. And step 10, which is extending the lesson, would be to share the posters with the district nutrition director to be selected for distribution throughout the whole school. So that's the way you would sort of take one of the standards and break it down to a unit and break it down to an actual lesson. There are so many vendor and commercial-based lessons that are out there that are already created, but this is something you want to look for in each of those lessons. You want to ensure that the core concept is taught and assessed. You want to ensure there's an opportunity for students to be able to explore and engage and critique and build upon those higher order critical thinking skills. Is it student-centered learning where children are really participating in their own learning experiences? Are there formative skills? And as I said, the model that I saw in health education is that all of those skills that move beyond core concept are formative, whereas advocacy and self-management are more summative. Now, think about how you take all of what's in those standards and put them into a unit and a lesson. This is just one example that I shared with you. You can come up with examples of your own. So if part of the class, you're doing the assignment where you have to create a lesson, this is one example of how to do it. And we'll embed this within all of the folders in Blackboard in our course. So if you're here for HEA 300, this is where we explore and we develop and we critique. And HEA 495, which is taken in concert with 300, that's where all the resources and exemplars and samples are shown. So thank you for joining us today on our topic of lifetime fitness and nutrition. We recognize that this is a national issue for us, but working collaboratively as advocates and educators through our district and school wellness policies, we all can have a positive impact on addressing chronic childhood and adult obesity. And we'll see you next time.